Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
To get led astray, Lord, we pray now that you would use him to speak your word to us, your truth, that we can stay, keep our eyes on the good shepherd, that being you. We ask that now in Jesus' name, and everyone said,
Amen.
Well, praise the Lord, guys. This is a beautiful day the Lord's given us, and I'm very grateful for that nice breeze right now. He has sent us to, he turned on our AC for us. Because if you were here earlier while we were setting up, it was just a really light AC, and he just turned it up just for you guys to get here in time. So very grateful for the Lord, his kindness toward us. And this morning we're going to look at Romans chapter 3. This is one of the passages of scripture that I think probably one of the most quoted. There's a verse in this passage in chapter 3. It's probably one of the most quoted verses of the whole New Testament. And some of you are already familiar with it. In verse 23, it says, how many of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God? You guys know verse 23? It says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We all, not one of us has made a perfect hit of the mark, as they would say. This is taken from an archery term, to hit the mark. You know, when you shoot an arrow at the bullseye, If you shot arrows and you pulled back on the drawstring and let go and the arrow didn't quite have enough oomph on it, you know, it would fall short. That was the idea of missing the mark, falling short of that mark, that perfection. And Paul uses a term that was common in their day to say, you know, we've all missed that mark. There's not one of us that's perfect. And it's interesting to me because Paul the Apostle is going to use just a plethora of quotes from the book of Psalms, as he's going to point out in just basically putting psalm back to back with another psalm to another psalm, and pull out the point that there's not one of us that's righteous. If you look at verse 10, he says, as it's written, there's none righteous, not even one. There's none who understands. There's none who seeks for God. They all have turned aside together. They're useless. There's not one who does good. There's not even one, he says. Now, he's just quoting the psalmist who says, this is the way of man. There's not any man that is perfect. Now, you guys, I don't think you came to church to find out that we're not perfect. We pretty much got... I never went to church and said, wow, I wonder if I'm perfect or not. I mean, I came knowing I wasn't perfect. That was a given. So to me, Romans 3 doesn't seem... earth-shatteringly, you know, profound in that way, because I know I'm not perfect. But I think that there's something deeper here that Paul wants to bring out, and it is really important for our faith to be established in humility. That if we look at, you know, Paul had just made a big discourse about the Jews and the Greeks in chapter 2, how that there were some Jews that they didn't actually live their Judaism. They didn't live that circumcision, as Paul described, of the heart. He said, whereas there were Gentiles, non-Jewish people, who actually live more like the Jews were supposed to, but they didn't even have the rules. They didn't have the law. It says, but they were a law unto themselves. Have you ever met non-Christians that live really good moral lives? Or they're really kind people, and you're like, that guy's not even a Christian. He's kinder than most of the Christians I know. I mean, I hate to say this, but sometimes some of the Christians I know are jerks. And they're like, but I'm saved. I'm like, yeah, you're saved, but you're still a jerk. And I mean, come on, let's face it. There are sometimes you run into these people, and Paul would say they're living the law without the law. They don't have the rules written out, but they just by the way they know it's not right to treat your fellow man cruelly or to kick a man when he's down. They know this, these things, you know, do unto others as you'd have them what? Do unto you. What we were taught in school is the golden rule. Well, that is taught from the scripture. But there are some people who don't even have the rules for them, and yet they live it. And so Paul had just got done saying that the ones who live it, they're the ones that are truly of what God considers the circumcision of the heart. They cut away the living their life for the wrong reasons, for after the flesh, and they're living the way God would want them. And so Paul says, well then, look at verse 1 of Romans 3. He says, what advantage then is it to be a Jew? I mean, if a non-Jew can live it without having the rules, and he can be accepted of God, then what's the advantage? And was Paul Jewish? Before I go any farther, we need to establish this. Was Paul a Jew? Yeah. He was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He's way up in the Jewish hierarchy. He had done all the steps of Judaism. In fact, he said, as concerning his zeal, he says, I was advancing above my contemporaries. I was leading the charge. He was the one that got the letter from the leaders of the synagogue to go out and persecute the Christians. That's when his name was Saul, before God changed it to Paul. But he was zealous, not for the right things, but zealous. So, sometimes people say to me, aren't you worried about those zealous guys that are doing wrong? And I'm like, not really. Those make the best converts. They're just zealous for the wrong thing. You know, how zealous do you think someone who's willing to blow themselves up for their faith, maybe some of these ISIS guys, you know, I know that this is going to rock some people's thinking, but I know at church, some people are like, pray that God just smites them and takes them out. And I'm thinking, how about praying that they get converted like Saul did to Paul? Because if they're that zealous for the wrong, how zealous would they be for the truth? I mean, would they make good proclaimers of the truth if they're that willing to die for a lie? How about we teach them the truth and they get free? And they could walk in salvation like we do. What a blessing that would be. And, you know, when we pray, it says we're to pray for our enemies. I pray for their salvation, that they would be saved. Now, Paul says, so what's the advantage of being a Jew? This is how Romans 3 starts off. Let me read it to you. It says here, or what benefit is there of being of the circumcision, the party of the circumcision? He says, well, great in every respect. First of all, they were entrusted with the oracles of God. And these guys, the Jews got to have God's law granted to them. He gave the Ten Commandments to them through Moses. And then the Levites, the Levitical priesthood, took those Ten Commandments and they broke it down into 613 statutes. They each part of the Ten Commandments, they broke it down into how to apply it in your daily life. Now, that's a dry read, I admit. But the book of Leviticus tells you, like, the stuff that, you know, if your ox goes and gores your neighbor's ox, then what's the right thing to do? You know, and it literally spells out what you're to do. To take the meat of the ox and to share the meat and to take the guy who lost his ox, got to give it to the other guy. You know, it says basically the right thing to do in love. What you would do if you truly loved someone. Like Jesus said, love your neighbor as what? As yourself. Love him the way you love yourself. What would you want done for you? That just answers it all. If you really want to boil Leviticus down into practical, like, I'll just give you the theme. It basically boils down to, what would you want someone else to do for you if, you know, if they were doing that? Hey guys, this is one of the best, sweetest parts I know for my faith right here. In Romans 3, it says that, in verse 3, what then, Paul says, what's the advantage of being a Jew? He says, well, it's great because you have the oracles of God. And then he says, what then, if some did not believe, their unbelief will not nullify the faithfulness of God. If we don't believe, does that change God's faithfulness? I like what Paul wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy in chapter 2. He said in verse 13, even if we're faithless, God remains what? Do you guys know this verse? Faithful. I mean, even if our faith is faltering and we're like, I feel weak, I don't know if I can make it, I don't know if I could deal with someone who's demon possessed. I don't know if I could deal with some problems like Jesus did. Does that change God's faithfulness?
No.
You know, I was trying to think of a good example of, you know, sometimes we think things have to, we have to have the belief for things to be, I don't know, solid or stable in our lives. But Jesus is our rock. And it says, and it's on him we stand. If, to people, you know, when it comes to their faith, they don't realize it, but every day you exercise faith in small ways, just in your day-to-day life. You came and you said, well, I'm going to see. I guess I have faith this Rubbermaid chair is going to hold me up, right? I mean, you put your weight down on it. Some of you went a little slow just to make sure. Test it out. Yeah, okay, seems to be holding. But if I could tell you, look, I know that those chairs will hold you because we have a brother that weighs, you know, a little bit larger. We put him in all the chairs to make sure. Just to you know, we pre-tested him. And he weighs more than all you guys. So I just to check it out, get a 350-pound guy and make him sit on your Rubbermaid chairs, and then if they survive, then okay, we'll use them. And somebody will laugh at me, like, you really use a 350-pound thing? Yeah, why not, man? That way I know they're going to work. Now, if I tell you that I did that, then it might give you a little more faith, like, oh, I could sit in this chair, I don't have to worry, it's going to hold. But see, the Bible tells us faith is an assurance of things hoped for, but an evidence of things not seen. We don't always see it, we don't always understand it, we don't always know it, but God is a God that says, you can trust me. Even when your faith is not strong, even when you're struggling with your faith, I remain faithful. I'm there for you. And the thing is that the Lord is so kind. When our faith is weak and we're struggling, he says, I'm still here for you. And then Paul goes on and he says, listen, does our unbelief nullify the faithfulness of God? May it never be. It won't, you know, if we struggle, you ever had a bad faith week? That's what I'm going to call it. Like, your faith meter's like pegging near the low end of the range and on the meter, and you're going, man, I don't know. I want to believe, but I'm struggling in my faith. Well, Paul says, just because you have unbelief, it won't nullify God's faithfulness. God will still be faithful. And his faithfulness, well, he says, his faithfulness will be found true, though every man be found a liar. As it is written, he says, that you may be justified in your words and prevail when you are judged. Now, it's interesting. He says, but if our unrighteousness demonstrates the righteousness of God, what shall we say then? The God who inflicts wrath is not unrighteous, is he? He says, I'm speaking in human terms. God is faithful no matter how our faith goes. He never wavers. But what's interesting is, I told you, Paul's a Pharisee of Pharisees. He knew the scripture. He picks I would say this pretty obscure verse. How many of you have heard this verse? That you might be justified in your words and prevail when you are judged. Do you guys know where this is? This is from the Psalms. Psalm 51, verse 4. Now, Psalm 51, I know some of you know, are acquainted with this psalm, because this is the psalm David wrote after he sinned with Bathsheba. And we sing a song in our worship time, create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit. Remember that song? Create in me a clean heart, O God. Well, that's verse 10. This verse comes six verses before it. And I want to show you, would you turn me to the psalm? Instead of going real far through Romans 3 today, I think with the interruption, I'm just going to do the psalm. Psalm 51, where Paul is quoting from. Because if you get the context of this psalm, you might see a whole new thing when we turn back to Romans 3 next week. You're gonna really appreciate this passage. Because here, he says in Psalm 51, he says, this is the psalm that David wrote after Nathan, the prophet, came into him. And after he had gone into Bathsheba. This is the psalm where he wrote, be gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness. according to the greatness of your compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgression, and my sin is ever before me. Now, David's writing this psalm after Nathan came to visit him. I know some of you might not be familiar with the story, but let me just give you the kind of Reader's Sparks notes or whatever, Reader's Digest. Because this story, this part will really open up this psalm to you. This is written, when Nathan came was in 1 Samuel. In chapters 11 and 12, here, keep one finger here, or a marker, in Psalm 51, and turn to 1 Samuel, and I'll show you, I'm sorry, 2 Samuel, 2 Samuel 11 and 12. In chapter 11, we read, "Then it happened in the springtime, at the time when the kings go out to battle, that David sent Joab," that was his commander, "and his servants, with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the sons of Ammon, and they besieged Rabbah. But David," it says, "stayed at Jerusalem." So what time of year is it? It's just, I'm going to paint the picture. The springtime. You know, in Jerusalem in the springtime, the poppy seeds, the wildflowers start like blooming on the sides of the hills, and the scent just changes the scent in the desert there. It's a deserty region where Jerusalem was, but when those flowers all start to bloom, the wildflowers, it's just beautiful. There's a light scent of just this really, really light flowery scent that just kind of wafts through the air just because of the wildflowers that are blooming. So this is that time of year. Now this is a time of year customarily where the kings would go out to war. And so David was now the king of Israel, and yet it says he sent Joab and his servants and all of them to go fight, but he stayed back in Jerusalem. Springtime, he's at home. And we read here, "Now when evening came, David arose from his bed, and he walked around on the roof of the king's house." This is very common in their culture. The rooftop and the houses in the Middle East, they use them for, we call it like a lanai, or a patio. It's an extra living space. But it's deserty, so it's hot in the day. A lot of times they put earth right on top of their house and plant a garden, and it kind of keeps like a barrier to keep the inside of the house cooler. It's pretty practical. And in the evening time, when the desert cools off, you know, you go up to your rooftop to just, that's like the cool spot to go in, you know, in your house. It's not really in your house, on your house. But you go up on the roof, and he's up there on the roof, and it says, and from his roof, now remember, David's the king, he's up on the top of the hill in Jerusalem. And so from his roof, you guys know what happens. He sees a woman bathing, and she was very beautiful in appearance. And so when David sent and inquired about this woman, and they said, "Is this not Bathsheba?" Now I laugh because her name is Bathsheba. So she was taking a bath. It was always easy for me to remember her name in Sunday school. She was the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite. Now pay attention to that part. The wife, she's married to this man Uriah the Hittite. So David sent messengers, and they took her. And when she came to him, it says, he lay with her. And when she had purified herself from her uncleanness, she returned to her house. Now the woman conceived, and she sent and told David and said, "I am pregnant." Then David sent to Joab and said, "Send me Uriah the Hittite." So Joab sent Uriah to David. Now when Uriah came to him, David asked concerning the welfare of Joab and the people and the state of war. And then David said to Uriah, "Go down to your house and wash your feet." And Uriah went out of the king's house, and it says, and a present from the king was sent out after him. Why is the king sending a present? "Here, Uriah, here's a present for you." Who's Uriah anyway in the whole battle scheme? He has this guy come back from the battle. Why? You guys know what he's up to, right? He's trying to do a cover-up. It says, so he's like, "Here's a present. Go see your, you know, go down to your house, see your wife." Hoping that he'll go home and, you know, like a good soldier, then out in the field, gets home with his wife, he's gonna be with her, and then when it's found out she's pregnant, he'll just be like, "Oh, that was when I was on leave, when I came back to see the king," you know? That's probably what David's up to. this is a cover-up. But Uriah slept at the king's, the door, it says, of the king's house with all the servants of his lord, and he did not go down to his house. Now when they told David this, Uriah did not go down to his house. David said to Uriah, have you not come from a journey? Why don't you go down to your house? And Uriah said to David, the ark and Israel and Judah are all staying in temporary shelters, and my lord Joab and his servants, my lord, are camping in the open field. Shall then I go to my house and eat and drink and lie with my wife? By your life and the life of your soul, I will not do this thing. This guy is so upright. He's like, I can't be having the pleasures of my own bed and my own wife and my own food. My fellow soldiers are out there in the field, and the ark of the Lord is out there. I mean, that would be wrong. So David said to Uriah, stay here today also and tomorrow, and I'll let you go. So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day and the next. And David called him, and he ate, and he drank before him, and he made him drunk in the evening. And he went out to lie on his bed with his lord's servants, but he did not go down to his house. Now David keeps him around a couple extra days to do what? Just hoping, man. Let's get this guy a little tipsy. Maybe then he'll go. Right? He's still trying to work the cover up to get this guy to cover up his sin. In the morning it says David, when he saw that he couldn't get the guy to go home, he wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. Now this part I really... This is where it goes bad. I mean, bad to bad, bad. Look at this. In the letter he had written, he says in verse 15, place Uriah in the front line of the fiercest battle and withdraw from him so that he may be struck down and die. So it was that Joab kept watch on the city, and that he put Uriah at the place where he knew there were valiant men. And the men of the city went out and fought against Joab, and some of the people among David's servants fell, and Uriah the Hittite also died. Uriah carried his own death orders. Didn't know it because the king sealed it to give this to Joab, and he carries his own... Can you imagine that? He's carrying his own... And David is doing this why? Because he slept with the man's wife. And by the way, this is the guy who is the king of Israel. The man who we read in the Psalms, it says, was a man after God's own heart. Now, why am I telling you all the dirt on him? I didn't write this. This was in the book. And this is the lead up to the Psalm we're just going to read, which is the Psalm which Paul is going to quote when he says, there's none righteous. Who's he pick? I mean, it might seem obscure to us because he grabs one little part of a verse from Psalm 51. But if you're a good Jew, would you know that that's the psalm that David wrote after he got busted by Nathan? Well, wait, I haven't got to Nathan yet. Sorry. Wait, I got ahead of the story. Wait, let me just read you the rest. This is juicy stuff right here. Okay. He puts him up there. They withdraw. And then Joab sent a report to David of all the events of the war. And he charged the messenger, saying, when you have finished telling the events of the war to the king, if it happens that the king's wrath rises and he says to you, why did you go so near the city and fight? Do you not know that they would shoot from the wall? Who struck down Abimelech, the son of Jerubbaal? Was it not a woman? She threw an upper millstone on him from the wall so that he died there at Thebes. Why did you go so near the wall? And you shall say to him, you know, when the king's throwing a rant about, remember the gal who threw the millstone, and he starts going, he says, you just say to him, your servant Uriah the Hittite is dead also. Okay, you're the messenger to bring bad news to the king. Is that a... By the way, back then, that was a bad job. You were not supposed to bring bad news to the king. And he comes, he says, now, in case he starts getting mad, just throw in this one other little line. So also, your servant Uriah the Hittite is dead. So the messenger departed. He came, he reported to David all that Joab had sent him to tell. Verse 23 says, and the messenger said to David, the men prevailed against us, and they came out against us in the field, and we pressed them as far as the entrance of the gate. Moreover, the archers shot at your servants from the wall. So some of your king's servants are dead, and your servant Uriah the Hittite is dead also. He threw it in right away. He didn't wait. Smart little guy. He's, you know, Joab said to say this. I'm just going to say it. Then David said to the messenger, thus you shall say to Joab, Do not let this thing displease you, for the sword devours one as well as another. Make your battle against the city strong and overthrow it, and so encourage him." So he cryptically tells the messenger, just go tell him, yeah, it, you know, happens to all of us, and it's a battle, and, you know, just keep up the good fight, you get him. Keep it up. So, I got a question for you. This did not just cost Uriah's life. Did you notice it says, and the other men that were with them? David's sin, with his sin of pleasure with a woman, will wind up costing men in his army to die needlessly, just to try to cover up his sin. So we read in verse 26, when the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she mourned for her husband. When the time of mourning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife, and she bore him a son. But the thing that David had done was evil in the sight of the Lord. Now chapter 12 of 2 Samuel goes on to say, then the Lord sent Nathan to David. This is where it gets really good. Nathan is the prophet. Okay, back then. So Nathan comes, and he says to David, there were two men in this one city. One was rich, and the other was poor. The rich man had great many flocks and herds, but the poor man, he had nothing except one little ewe lamb, just a little baby lamb. It says, but he had bought it and nourished it, and it grew up together, it says, with him and his children. It was like the family pet. And so it would eat of his bread, it would drink of his cup, it would lie there in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. And a traveler came to the rich man, and the rich man was unwilling to take even one of his own flock or of his own herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him. Rather, he took the poor man's ewe lamb and prepared it for the man who had come to him. When David heard this, it says in verse 5, his anger burned greatly against the man, and he said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, surely this man who has done this deserves to die. He must make restitution for the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and had no compassion. And then Nathan the prophet said this. You guys know he's going to be right. He looks at him and says, you are the man. David's like, busted. I put that into what this is saying. Thus says the Lord God of Israel, it is I who anointed you king over Israel, and it is I who delivered you from the hand of Saul. It is I also who gave your master's house and your master's wives into your care, and I gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if that had been too little a thing, I would have added to you many, many, many more things like these. I've already made you like the rich man. Why have you despised the word of the Lord by doing evil in his sight? You struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword. You have taken his wife, his lamb, to be your wife. You killed him with the sword of the sons of Ammon. Now therefore the sword shall never depart from your house, Nathan says, because you despise me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. And thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against you from your own household. I will even take your wives before your eyes and give them to your companion, and he will lie with your wives in broad daylight. Indeed, you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel under the sun. You're the king. You did this in secret. Thought you were going to get away. God goes, I'm going to bust you. I'm going to let all Israel see. And then David said to, now listen to this. Then David said to Nathan, I have sinned. And I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said to David, the Lord also has taken away your sin, and you shall not die. However, because by this deed you have given occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born to you shall surely die. And Nathan then went away to his house. So he said, David, it's one thing David's recognizes his sin. He didn't say, I sinned against man. Did you notice that? Oh, I've sinned against man. No, he said, I sinned against who? The Lord. He's like, man, my sin. And so Nathan tells him, the Lord has taken away your sin. You shall not die. Now, God could have smoked David right then for that. But he didn't. because David had something that, you know, it says he was a man after God's own heart. What do you think was so pleasing to God about this man? He's quick to repent, wasn't he? I mean, he blew it. There's no question whether he blew it. And to me, there's no question that Paul is picking probably the best. I mean, if the Jews want to stand on their laurels, you know, well, we have the heritage. We have the guys that God chose, and we have our forefathers, and we have King David. We're a son of David. You know, that was a big thing to like associate with. Yeah, so Saul goes, let me pick a verse that puts it in perspective for you. Very first verse he picks is plucked right out of the psalm that David writes after this. Right after Nathan leaves him, it says that, well, this is what happened. I'm sorry, let me tell you what happened to the child. Because this might help give you some insight into the psalm. It says, then the Lord struck the child that Uriah's widow bore to David, so that he was very sick. And David therefore inquired of God for the child. David fasted and went and lay all night on the ground. And the elders of his household stood beside him in order to raise him up from the ground. But he was unwilling, and he would not eat food with them. And it happened on the seventh day that the child died. And the servants of David were afraid to tell him that the child was dead. For they said, behold, while he was still alive, we spoke to him, and he did not listen to our voice. How can we tell him that the child is dead, since he might do harm to himself? They were so worried. If we tell him, and he's already been distraught and laying on the ground, he won't even get up. But when David saw his servants were whispering together, David perceived that the child was dead. So David said to the servants, is the child dead? They said, he is dead. And so David arose from the ground and washed himself and changed his clothes and came into the house of the Lord and worshipped. And he came into his own house and requested that they set food before him. And he ate. And his servant said to him, what is this thing you've done? While the child was alive, you fasted and wept. But when the child died, you arose and ate food. Now this is backwards to their thinking. When someone dies, that's when they wept and they have fasting, you know. Not when they're alive. He's done the exact opposite. So what are you doing? And he said, while the child was still alive, I fasted and wept. For I said, who knows? The Lord may be gracious to me, that the child may live. But now that he has died, why should I fast? Can I bring him back again? He says, I will go to him, but he will not come to me. And then David comforted his wife Bathsheba, went into her and lay with her again. And she gave birth to him a son. And they named him what? You guys know this. Solomon. Now the Lord loved him. And he sent word through Nathan the prophet. And he named him Jedidiah, for the Lord's sake. Jedidiah is Solomon's given name, what we would call his, I'm trying to think, you know, in some people's upbringing, when they go to the church for the dedication, they give a name, like
a sacred name,
yeah. His sacred name was Jedidiah. I know a lot of people don't know that Solomon's name from the Lord was Jedidiah, which means beloved of the Lord. So this is kind of significant, because it's the same mom, right? It's Uriah's wife, Bathsheba, and David. But now there's been a change of heart in David. God has worked with him. And now he says, I'm going to give you, you know, this is the replacement. Your sin has been forgiven. This is the part we got to remember. How good is God at forgiving sin? I mean, the Bible says if we confess our sin, he's faithful, he's righteous, he cleanses us of all unrighteousness. And he takes our sin as far as east is from west, and he removes it from us. Now, why do I say that's important? Because it says you have to confess your sin. Did David confess his sin?
Yes.
Well, this is where Psalm 51 comes in. The psalm that gets quoted in Romans 3 is right here. Look at Psalm 51, where we see David crying out to God, be gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the greatness of your compassion, blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, cleanse me from my sin, for I know my transgression and my sin is ever before me. Did he know he had sinned?
Yes.
Did he confess he had sinned? God, I'm a sinner. You know, sometimes they say, what prayer do you pray to get forgiveness? I said, it's pretty simple. It goes like this. God, I'm a sinner. I confess that. You know, I mean, you can't, there's no skirt in that part. If you want to get right with God, you got to just call it like it is. I got sin. And when you do that, and you just call it what it is, God goes, good, now we're on the same page. Let me take care of that. And so we read on, it says, David said, against you and you alone have I sinned and done what was evil in your sight, so that you are justified when you speak and you are blameless when you judge. God, you got my number. You know I did wrong. You're justified when you judge. You're blameless. When you speak, you're just. Everything, you got me. Behold, he says, I was brought forth in iniquity. In sin my mother conceived me. He said, but behold, you desire truth in the innermost being, in the hidden part. You make me know wisdom, he says. You're the God that works inside. You reveal things to me inside. David says in verse 7, purify me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Where'd he get that one? Remember Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18? White as snow, white as... Though my sin be as scarlet, right? The Lord will make it... David cries this out, what Isaiah had said. Make me white as snow. Make me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sin, Lord. Blot out all my iniquities, and create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a steadfast spirit within me, and do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of your salvation, and sustain me, he says, with a willing spirit. Make me have the spirit, that right spirit. King James says, renew a right spirit within me. His spirit got wrong. He says, and then, verse 13, then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will be converted to you. If you ever have a friend that you know is transgressing, they're sinning, and you want to help them be converted to the Lord, let me tell you, I see that there's a progression that you have to do. Before David says, then I will teach transgressors your way, then the sinners will be converted to you, he says, first, God, create in me a clean what?
Heart.
A heart. Renew a right spirit. Where's he saying to start with? Before you go work, you know, you're praying for your friend's salvation. Well, you got to start with you. Get you right with the Lord first, and then the Lord can work on that. If you try to say, let me teach the sinner how to get it right, but you don't want God to get you right. Do they see through that, by the way?
Yeah.
They have a word for it. They call it hypocrites. And there's a lot of people who say, I'm not going to church anymore because they're all a bunch of hypocrites. And you know what? I have to be honest. I agree. There's some of them, I just think, they don't want to let God work. They want God to work on everybody else, but they never want to look at themselves. And the truth is, God wants to begin a revival, I believe, in our hearts first. He has to revive us. He has to wash away our sin. He has to renew a right spirit in us. He's the one that has to bring that part, that renewing, that joy of our salvation in us. And when we're walking in that joy of our salvation, then we can teach others about the Lord. You know, when they say, why are you a Christian, man? You don't understand. It wasn't for the Lord. I have this great joy. I have this hope inside. No matter what the worst thing would happen to me, somebody kills this body, then, well, the Bible tells me I have assurance of my salvation. As soon as I'm absent from this body, I'll be present with the Lord. I'll be like in heaven, and I'll be sitting there going, man, I'm done. I finished the race. I fought the good fight. You know, I'm reminded of Pastor Chuck Smith when it started Calvary Chapels. The pastor of Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa, he used to say, guys, if I'm ever, you know, comes that day the Lord says, you're done, Chuck, and I have a heart attack, but I fall down on the ground, I'm dead. And he says, and one of you young whippersnappers, all excited about the Lord, comes up and says, oh Lord, we don't want you to take Chuck. Please just let him come back and be here with us. And you lay hands on me and you pray over me to come back. And I was, you know, my spirit's there with the Lord. I'm with the Lord. And all of a sudden I feel myself put back in this earthly body. See, the first thing I'm going to do when I wake up, I'm going to knuckle punch you. And it, but the way he would say it was like, he's trying to express, you know, how glorious it will be on that day when we finish the race and we're with the Lord. And this will be just but a memory. You know, he's like, yeah, now that's the substance of real faith. That you know that that's the hope we have, that someday when we're done, this is just going to be, wow, it's over, we're done, we're finally finished. And the Bible says we get new bodies made by God, eternal, in the heavens. They're not going to be like these ones. I had a dream that I saw Donnie. I told her, do you mind if I tell him, Donnie? I had a dream this last night. I dreamed that I went to heaven, and Donnie was there already before me, and she came up, she had red, long curls, and I was just beautiful. She said, listen to this. And she's so just radiating beauty in the Lord, and she's just gorgeous. And I was like, she just came running to me. Yes! And I was like, Donnie! And I was like, wow. And she's like, I've been waiting for you. It took a while, you know. And I was like, that's not fair, you know. See, I don't like people taking cuts in line. I've been at this a while. You know, I wish that it worked like on first come, first serve basis, you know. Like, when did you come to the Lord? I came to the Lord in February 1979. So if you didn't come in before me, then I don't want you leaving before me. You stick around and preach and I'll go. You know, that's my simplistic. But is that the way the Lord does it sometimes? No. And you know, my heart was heavy last night. I was praying, going to sleep for our brother Steve, his wife Cookie, because Steve's body is failing. Going to him, to Cookie this week. And she says all he wants to do is go to heaven. His body is at that place, you know, the cancer's eaten up, and it's just, he's just like, I'm done. Now that's hard for us as loved ones to want to see someone we care about to leave. And sometimes some people ask me, why does God allow suffering like that, you know? And I think sometimes it's on behalf of the loved ones. Because there comes a certain point I've noticed being bedside with some people when they're suffering that finally the family says, you know, and the early part they're like, oh, you can beat this, fight it, you can just be strong, and you know, as the cancer eats away, they, you know, they pretty soon they see the suffering, the immense suffering there, and they're finally something changes in the family. They're like, man, I just wish that they could be free from this pain. I wish that they could be just able to go be with the Lord. And sometimes it's part of the letting go process. I notice God is gracious to all of us. He knows what we need to let go sometimes. Sometimes the hardest ones to console are the ones that somebody is just taken from us quickly. You know, like senselessly. They were killed in an accident last night. What? I was just talking to him yesterday. You know, and it's just the shock. Whereas if it's been drug out over months of pain, we're like, man, God have grace, let him go. I was praying for Steve last night. Lord, just send some angels to take him home. You know, let him just close his eyes here and open them in heaven. You know, I don't know about you, I always think dying in my sleep will be a good way. Probably have some demon-possessed guy come and kill me, but hey, I always tell the demon-possessed guys, you want to kill me, I'm going to let you, but I'm going to pray for you to have my anointing. And every life that I was supposed to touch, you're going to get my job. But not just my job. I'm going to pray double. You have to double preach what I would have to preach if I stayed here. So go ahead. I did that, by the way, one time to a Satanist. He just went, you are crazy, and ran off. He didn't want to do it. But you know what? It's the substance of my faith. Am I going to be with the Lord someday? Is this really real? You know, putting my faith in the Lord is a real thing. Jesus is not a fable. He's not a fairy tale. They didn't have ABC on the calendar because it was about, you know, before Crayolas or before cookies or, I mean, you play dumb sometimes. What's that BC thing? Before Christ, you idiot. Yeah, that's right. The
is right. The Christ came, the Savior of the world came, Jesus came, and my faith has substance. And I'm not standing preaching, I'm better than anyone. I know I'm a sinner, but I'm a sinner who said, God, forgive me. And God said, okay. Because the Bible says he is faithful to forgive us our sins and cleanse. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful. And if we're unfaithful, what did Paul say? He remains what? Faithful. There's nothing you can do to change his faithfulness. It just, he can't change it. It will always be solid. There'll be a rock you can stand on. It's like, you don't have to worry. I was thinking, you know, about these chairs that I put my feet and put my weight in. What if I had one when I was a kid? Did you guys go to that Barnum and Bailey circus with the elephant and the... They had this little stool. And the guy came out one day, he said, how many clowns do you think we can put on this stool? And the stool was tiny. I mean, it's like a little metal stool, but he's like, how many people do you think we can fit? And they stacked all these people on the stool. And it looked like a flimsy little stool, right? Then he took it up a notch. He brought out an elephant. And he put all the people on the elephant. Then he put the elephant with one foot on the stool. And this elephant was crazy. I don't know how this elephant did this. One leg, and it lifted up his back leg, and it lifted up his front leg, and then it proceeded to lift the third leg, and it was balancing one, just one thing, with all these people on his back, on the stool. And he said, did you think the stool was going to hold? And I was thinking, no way, because it looks like, you know, I don't know, just a couple little pieces of metal tubes, and it just looked like flims, for sure. An elephant with all those people, and first he did the people thing, and I didn't think it was going to hold. Then he did the elephant thing, and then I went, that's a good stool. I think we should use that design. You know, where did he get that stool? Now, if I had a stool like that, I said, you don't have to worry. This stool will not fail you. And it's been tested by elephants with people on top. You can use it to put your feet on. You can use it to park your car on. You can use it. I mean, it's a good stool. When you find out something is solid that you can put your faith in, you're not crazy for putting your faith in that. Because it's been proven. And you're not crazy for putting your faith in Jesus. Because he's been proven. It's not a fairy tale. It's not a fable. You're not foolish for believing in Jesus. You're just putting your faith in something solid. Something that can handle. And that's what we want to... That way, when that we let God work in us, then we can tell others about him, and then, like David said, then they will believe. Then that's when the real impact comes, when we start to live it. Don't be a hypocrite, live this, and then you can share with others, and they'll say, wow, thanks, for sure. They can see that you're genuine, they really can. That's what we want to be in the world. So that's my encouragement to you this week. Next week, I don't know if I'll do every psalm. He quotes, like, I'm talking all over the place just to bring out that next part about non-righteous. You probably all know that, right? Is there anyone here feels that you're perfect, righteous? You know, that's not going to surprise you next week, okay? You're just going to be like, yep, we know that part. But then we get to the part that the answer that comes from that. Paul's a great master of building thoughts upon another thought, upon another. And it just, like, it builds my faith to read it. Things what the Holy Spirit gave to him, they just, they speak down to the real depths of my faith. You know, they're the things like that you need, the like firm foundational stuff for your faith. So if you have time, read the rest of Romans 3 into chapter 4. I don't think I'll get all the way to 4, but at least you'll know where it's going. And it kind of helps to know the context where the flow is going. So we'll go into that next week, okay? Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this time we've had together. Sorry about the disruption, Lord, of that man, but I want to close by praying for him, for his soul. That you would free him, Lord, from the demons that have deceived him, and that you would open his eyes, Lord, just as you opened David's eyes to his sin, you opened my eyes to mine. You've opened our eyes, Lord, and you've set us free. We just pray freedom would come to that man that came up in the middle of service. We ask that, Lord, as we close together in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Amen. You guys want to sing a closing song? Let's do a quick...
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.